It is my great pleasure and absolute honour to be able to have Welby with us here today and being recorded so we can share the Welby around the country. So come on up, please, Professor Welby. The floor is yours.
Kia ora mai tātou. Ngā mihi nui naku ki a koutou katoa. Ina mana, ina reo, ina mate, ina whānau o Tamaki Makara. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Can we flip up the first image? It's not... Oh, that... No, not that! Oh, clicker on the table. Here we go. All right. That's great. Here we go. Okay. You know, when I was at school, I got saved by a careers advisor. This was before I was slung out, but at Te Ōmutu College, because I was in the dumb class, they couldn't find a teacher who was going to teach the naughty kids, well, the useless kids, really, English. And we got Mrs. Bunce. And Mrs. Bunce saw something that I didn't see, because for many people, you are the one last hope, the person who sees intelligence that might not be visible inside normal structures of schools. And I never thanked her. She died a few years ago. I never thanked her for I was destined to be shearing sheep like my dad in the wool sheds of Nauroma and Arahina. I love my dad, and I think shearing is a massive skill. But I got the chance to do something else, because somebody who was not tied into the regime of assessment and valuing, who stood outside of that but had a space in the school, was able to talk to me about life. So I have immense respect. When I was asked, I immediately said yes. And I also know that you guys here are the ones furthest along a road that not too many people are walking at the moment. You come out physically back out into the world, kanohi ke te kanohi, face to face, to deal with thought and with opportunity. So I admire, only the second public address I've done since things started opening up. So I thought, well, there's courage there. So what I hope is that in 30 minutes I might give you something that's either in your back pocket or an arm around your shoulder, that you might go away with that. So 30 minutes, all right. That's as much of a lesson plan as I ever do. So I started teaching at primary school. I taught for 5 years at Western Springs College and 3 years at Taihape College. So, I love secondary, I love that age in secondary education when people are beginning to try and understand who they are in the world. But since then, I've been at the university, and so currently I've got 14 PhD students. Sometimes they leave my brains like porridge, but I love them dearly. And many of them are uneven. Their intelligence is, it doesn't mean their intelligence is uneven, but much of their way of thinking often sits outside of the narrow sphere of what is rewarded in schools. So this is what I was going to talk about, a little bit about, I know, damn it, we're over it, but there's actually, I'm an optimist with things. I try and look at things to go, what do we get that's a plus from it? Then looking at what does it mean if we send our kids to university in a post-COVID environment? I'm not talking about Zoom meetings. Okay. What post-disciplinary is, disciplinarity, which is the thing that appears to be surfacing at the moment, how that looks in the real world, and then what holds change back? Okay, so what about COVID? Well, you know, in the first lockdown, I had 20 minutes to gather everything up from my office and flee, so all my plants died in my office. But one of the things that I noticed, an anomaly, which I realised later on it was a very indicative picture of New Zealand, was the number of teddy bears that started appearing in windows and on sofas and letterboxes. They look pretty manky now. The sun and water and everything got to them. It showed me something about our country. So I have a love affair with New Zealand. And although I work a lot, not recently, but I'm about to start again, work a lot overseas, I try to understand what it actually is about us that makes us different. And one of the things that really hit when I was communicating with other colleagues around the world, I was showing them photographs on the motorway, which where a campaign was based on be kind. So the concept of manaakitanga is very deeply embedded in our country, the fact that you look out for other people. It's not all about the heroic pursuit of the self, but that you are part of something, so that you would look after whānau first, you would look after community. And manky teddy bears on looking out of windows or on letterboxes are part of this thing. And so is bringing a nation through a time of uneven information, uneven change and crisis. So I looked at what happened to education. So this is the kids that you know, whether they are primary school or secondary school or tertiary. And there's some things that actually occurred inside their home environment, which I think makes it much easier for us. So parents saw their kids learning beyond time. So what I mean is they weren't divided into 30-minute or 45-minute or hour-and-a-half periods. That time, you know how time kind of dissolved when we were in lockdown? It became easy to forget what day it was, very easy to forget what day it was. But they saw people learn across large projects without being locked into periods. They saw that people would learn without assessment carrying the whip and the carrot, so that not all learning to be valid has to be driven by an assessment regime. They saw that FaceTime is not the same as social intimacy, that human beings need the warmth of each other's company. They need to physically be with, and if you don't do that, mental health starts getting affected. And then they saw learning beyond discipline, so that, and this became particularly prevalent in primary education, where kids were doing, because there were uneven resources around people's homes, that large project-driven things were not driven by this is reading, this is mathematics, this is social studies, this is whatever. It just went, here's the project, and we will bring to it whatever we want, which is actually really close to how we learn in the larger world. In fact, if you have a look at most of our learning occurs outside of school. Even if you're going to be really conservative and look at a school day. School day, you're there, let's say you're there from 9 to 3. For you guys, it's like 5 in the morning till about 9 at night, longer than that. But let's just say 8 hours at school. Let's pretend they sleep for 10 hours, they don't. But let's pretend that. Okay, so that leaves 9 to 10, 10 to 11, 11 to 12, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 6 hours, let's go 6 hours at school. That leaves a larger block of time when they're awake where they are learning on a school day, not a holiday or weekend, where they're learning outside of school, outside of those structures. Most of our, for instance, when we learned to imagine outside of school, we learned to speak our first language outside of school, we learned most of our social negotiations outside school. We even, I know this is controversial, but I would argue we even learned how to refine the ability to read mainly outside of school. If you go, I learned to read at school, thank a teacher, probably a little bit. If you ask yourself the question quietly when you go out of here, where did I really learn to read? Don't mean the basic. Where did I learn to be able to process complex information? It was probably outside of school. So people who interface between school and outside of school are hugely important because they have an awareness of this bridge and why it's so important. So I think that there is, for the first time in communities have seen in an embodied level different kind of learning that school still interfaces with, but they may be made up of some different principles. So then you ask yourself, if I'm working with kids coming to see me and they're thinking that they might go to university, what does that mean? Is that the same as it was in 2018, in 2020? And I would suggest it shifted. So, one of the things we know, that New Zealand's largest study of youth, so this is from 2021, the Youth 19 Survey, we know a couple of very dramatic things, and you know, you guys will know this really strongly. The level of anxiety and depression that the generation of kids coming through managing at the moment is really, really high. It's not someone being a wuss, it's really, really high. The levels are, and we experience it too. Very, very high levels of anxiety, very afraid of saying things that will cause them to be blowtorched internationally and have their reputation destroyed. Very, very anxious about positioning whatever they believe in a very safe place. And as a result, risk-taking tends to be minimalised. So we know that this is a sample of 7,890 secondary school students, 29% of females and 17% of males reporting symptoms of depression, which is about twice the rate of 2012. So similarly, between 2007 and 2019, the rate of good emotional well-being amongst teenagers fell from 78% to 69%. Do you know a really interesting thing? When we had the national conversation a few years ago, and basically the idea was, what if you went to the nation, employers, teachers, careers advisors, kids, people in prisons, whatever, a big collection of people, and go, what if you could imagine an education system for the next 30 years, what should it be driven by? And do you know the biggest aspiration that the nation told itself wasn't great performance outcomes to meet a matrix? It was hauora. It was that we would equip people to have sufficient well-being that when they went into a world that we couldn't see, they would have enough belief in their ability to adapt and survive and then generate new pathways. That was the big aspiration of this country. I hate the word well-being because in 1956, when my dad and mum named me Welby, and my dad's surname was Ings, that's my real name. I don't have new age hippie parents. Now, and everybody thinks that I was going to change my name to well-being. My middle name is John. I'm really, really ordinary guy. But, so I like the word hauora, but I also like that because the word has the idea that we might have a spirit inside it too. So it's not just a physical or mental well-being, it's a bigger wholeness. But that is what this country told itself that it wanted to see as the driving force. And that's why, you know, often in your offices, people come to you and that's a driving issue that's sitting underneath there. They are not well, their well-being is not in a good state. And while they use the hook of going, oh, you might be a careers advisor, actually you sit in such a special place in schooling, that you do much more than that. Much, much more than that. And I suspect that's probably why you're here today. So, one of the other things, so we know that we've got this issue of a diminished sense of well-being, but the other thing is that these kids live in an environment which we've seen graphically illustrated as a nation, where if you don't have critical discernment, you can go down rabbit holes really fast that are very dangerous. So we back even in the 70s, we were talking about critical thinking. But actually, unless you grow that, we have kids who are very, very vulnerable to very groomed bad information, bad knowledge, toxic knowledge. And they live in an environment based on whether something is liked. So if you go online, it's where, how many likes does it have? And so the ability to discern what is actually verifiable, not because somebody else has agreed with it, but verifiable fact or informed opinion and what isn't, now can cost you your life. It certainly can cost you your reputation, and it certainly can cost you a damaged future. So in a world where, for instance, if we're on our mobile device, we have the world's greatest library available, it sits inside the world's most toxic rubbish heap. And we've seen not just in communities and nations, but a world currently wrestling with situations where you have to be able to critically discern between what appear very groomed displays of knowledge, very groomed calling itself fact or informed. So we know that these kids come stepping into this with two quite demanding things. One, to restore and hold a sense of well-being, and the second one, the ability to recognize and discern what is valid information or useful information and what is toxically groomed, or a groomed toxin, sorry. So then you go, so what about a university? Well, I don't believe that universities are the only place that bright people go, thank heavens. You know, I didn't go into university. Oh, well, I went for 2 years and got show in the door, but that was because I was too young. But when I went back in my 30s, I was hungry for something. I was hungry for something that wasn't about strategically doing as little as I could to get a degree, but to hang out in a realm of ideas that would cause me to be unsettled, that would make me rethink things. And I'm always really proud in this country. You know, in 1989, we had an Edge Education Act that re-looked at what universities were. So they were not catacombs of culture. They were not the ivory towers of remote people who spread their pearls of wisdom before people and people clambered them together and tried to get a mark. The way the law looks at it is this, that all universities have to be driven by five key features, and they have shaped universities in New Zealand so that most of our universities all stand very high in the world rankings. And I won't advertise, but you know, AUT is really highly up there. Okay, so what are these attributes? The first one is that the job of the university is to develop independence of thought. Not dependent, so not going, what is it you want? Show me exemplars, show me the outcomes. Now I will groom my knowledge to do that. No, we are gifted by the nation, some of its finest thinkers, and our job is to generate independence. So that's the first thing. So they're not training institutions. Second, the people who teach on degrees have to be active researchers. In other words, they must be advancing knowledge themselves. Now, the reason I think that's important, some people go, oh, that's so you're up with the play. I don't think so. I think the real reason is that when I'm doing a research project, I'm faced with what it is to fail, what it is to take risks, what it is to pour your energy into something and not work. And also the wonder of being Indiana Jones and discovering something. And I think we become better educators, because if we are behaving independently in the world and have a visceral embodied sense of what that is, we are more likely to have empathy with people who we are trying to show and approaches that will do the same thing. So the third one, that the standards of research and teaching in New Zealand have to be international. So our work is always peer reviewed, and that's why you'll see thrown around, I have some misgivings with them, but things like international rankings or research that is internationally peer-reviewed, so that we don't stand as a little enclave. We have to be seen there comparatively with the best in the world. The fourth one is that they have to be a place where there is, where knowledge is valued and then held and made available for people. So it's not, I'm going to do this assignment, do it quietly handed and get my mark and now it goes away. The idea is you have to behave with generosity. So, you know, when somebody pays their fees, they're only paying a fraction of what the taxpayer is putting into their education. So when you do a thesis, it has to be made available publicly. It has to go online. So people go, oh no, I don't want people to read it. You go, don't do it then, because the taxpayer's not going to pay you money to glorify yourself with a qualification if you don't give back. And the last one, which I think is really interesting, not all countries have this. We accept the role as the critic and conscience of society, which means that sometimes from universities, you have to be able to step out in opposition to business interests, to political interests, and speak the truth as you know it from the knowledge base that you are working inside. And that independence is really, really important. And that's why in very oppressive societies, academics get taken out very quickly. So the role here, it's tied to this. The role is that you have to have the courage to stand up to opposition when you believe that you have verifiable or robust information that will question that. And that's a tough thing when you're working with people who, by a generation, have become quite afraid of that. So you can see what a university is actually around thinking people who give back, who do stuff and give back. So it's quite a different idea from the ivory tower and the black flapping capes. So Are we about halfway through now?
Yeah, we are.
Good, good. We're on time. Okay. So one of the things that I find really interesting is one of the emphases that universities place on things is to generate new knowledge. So it's not just cutting up and repasting knowledge that you've already... Like many of you, when you probably went through universities, and when we went through secondary school, we got a question, we went and found things, and we chopped it all up like a jigsaw puzzle and put it together, put an introduction at the end, beginning, conclusion at the end, went, there we go. But it didn't actually contribute anything new. So the aim of, especially if you get to a PhD, what marks a PhD out, is that it must contribute new knowledge. It must put something in the world that doesn't yet exist. And as part of that, one of the very interesting things that's happening is that the old disciplines of geography, politics, history, design, hotel and business study, business studies, have actually started to dissolve. Now, this is quite a frightening thing for an institutions that have been predicated on making those very clear divisions. But it actually has. So if I look at the students with whom I work, oh, no, actually, Tamara Erickson, she said something interesting. She was trying to understand why it is that some of the great students you've generated either have left school to go into business or they've come out of universities and they don't stay in places that are too constrained. So our really innovative thinkers were there for a short time, then going setting up their own businesses, setting up their own identity, setting up their own initiatives. And she said that this generation who grew up with no conscious memory of learning to use a computer had very high levels of technological understanding. They were used to being exposed to multiple ideas. They had very high expectations, especially of access to information and support, and that tended to be immediate. They understood that the world was made up of multiple opportunities and multiple truths. So they would look at something and there's a news version of it there and there and there and there, and they're all arguing against each other. And they lived in an environment of access and sharing. So these kids grew up in global economies in a digitized world. Knowledge is plural, where innovation, complexity and change were normal, that you worked collaboratively, and there was this idea of a shared commitment and responsibility. So the model that we have tended to use in education, and I don't just mean in teaching, I mean in many of our organizations, is I'm the knowing beast up here, and I'm so kind, I'm gonna help you, I'm gonna teach you all the things you need to get up to me here. So that's the protege model. But in fact, when you have a look at the more recent research, what seems to be working is a developmental model. The person with the light is not the leader. It's the person behind them. That's like a really good coach in sport. The sports person is the talented one, but the coach understands the context and the environment. They understand what will help that person get to where they need. So it's not a heroic role, but it's a very attentive role. So what does that look like? You go, well, it could be a whole lot of fluffy theory, so I'm going to tie it to four people who I work with who I admire, and they've all come through schools like yours. Okay, here's Jarek. So Jarek talked to you, I think he talked a couple of years ago. So he just finished his PhD a little while ago, and he calls himself an indie designer developer. So there's no, these things are blended. I shut up, let you just read. So here is somebody who moves across what is traditionally divided. So he designed games for visually impaired people. So these have won heaps of international awards now. So he doesn't go and go, I do the programming or I deal with the aesthetics or what. He does all those things. And then he surrounds himself with a community of people who can feed into, and they exchange, not in a hierarchy, but in a model of mutual support, a we environment. Tatiana, oh, she's one of those lovely people who's actually naturally modest, just took out 2 golds in the National Design Awards. She's just, but if you met her, she would start by introducing herself by apologizing. You know, But she talks about herself intellectually as a cross-disciplinary immigrant. So this is what she did. She designed a new form of novel that you read with your mobile device, and depending on which of the narrators you pick, it will give you a different version of each of the illustrations in the novel. Easier to explain it like this. Oh, can you pick the audio up?
Euclides was destined to be a martyr.
Euclides and Elsa were young and full of ideas.
Euclides and Elsa were young and fighters for freedom. His photograph shattered on the floor.
I would like to tell you a story of faith.
There is original sin, and God never forgets.
There is good and evil in this world. Both are necessary.
Illustrator, coder, author, a publisher, all those things together, works across beyond disciplines. So I'm going to move, I'm going to jump this because I just come to this. So one of the issues that we face, and you probably face it in your community at the moment, is that you're sometimes pushing uphill when you're trying to open up a different perspective away from the traditional environments that often parents have had. So most of the parents of the kids we teach grew up in a neoliberal education system. They were marked against a set of expectations. Everything was understood as that's how you go there. And the ground has shifted. So they grew up in an environment where they were measured, they were compared, they were performing, and education was a business. And when we start to try and talk with their kids about other ways and other approaches, anxiety comes back at us. So, the neoliberal teaching environment. There's misunderstandings about intelligence, not only like rubbish like IQ tests, which test only a kind of rational pattern-making thinking. So there are very, very advanced and complex forms of intelligence that don't get assessed in school, so they become invisible. So I enter here. Some years ago, you know how at the end of a year, sometimes kids bring you gifts. Some you go, oh, thank you. Oh, shit. And other ones are wonderful things. They really touch your heart. And one of my students gave me a wee quote from Oscar Wilde. Well, during lockdown, I read Oscar Wilde again because I hadn't got any new library books in, and now I think he's rubbish. But I didn't used to think he was rubbish. And he said this, and he said it about you. He said it about those of you who in our schools sit there to open doors that other people don't see. You have the conversations, and he called you dreamers, but not in a negative way. He said, a dreamer is someone who can only find their way by moonlight. And their punishment is that they see the dawn before the rest of the world. For everything you do in schools right now, for everything you've done, and for everything that you will open, as a nation, we're grateful. And as a university, thank you.